Joining me in the house today is a guest who holds a unique place in the nation's affections. For years, she has graced our screens in a variety, a great variety, in fact, of different guises, from comedy actress to presenter of the hugely popular Praise Be. She's also a BAFTA award winner with an incredible 104 films to her credit. Now, currently, she's in her seventh year in Britain's longest-running TV comedy series, Last of the Summer Wine. Dame Thora Hird. Really, really lovely to see you around this house. I'd love to keep you here permanently, I think. You grace our settee very well.
Oh, and do you think the colour?
I do. I think you look great. Do you know the thing that I admire about you, I think, more than anything, is your energy and your tenacity for work? You're brilliant.
Well, as long as I keep well, I say to myself, I've got something on the side of the bed, I must tell you, a little thing. No, I have. No, I don't mean not that fella who's been on. No, you're not. No, no. And it says on it, don't stop doing things because you're growing old, because you'll only grow old if you stop doing things. So I get up for rehearsal. I've been very, very busy this year again.
But is it a question that you purposely keep yourself busy, or do you genuinely just love your work so much?
Well, I love my work very much because I'm in a position where I do comedy one minute and tragedy another. I've just done another Bennett play.
Alan Bennett.
Yes, he's doing another Talking Heads. And I did that. And then 3 days after, I started another play that I've just done, which is called Lost for Words. That's because I've had a stroke. Get your hankies out, oh dear me. No, it's funny as well. And then next week, I go into the Victoria Wood play to play her mother. So the greatest thing about my life is that I'm wanted.
But, you know, we were doing a thing with a memory man yesterday and we were talking about learning and keeping your mind active and so on. Do you reckon that learning all the scripts that you have to keeps you really agile?
Well, of course, you know that Jimmy died 3 years ago and I miss him terribly on the book because it's not half so easy to learn, to teach yourself, you know, but never mind, I'm having a go. I think, you see, it's difficult to ask anybody to say, should you keep going when you're old? I keep going, A, because I'm wanted, which is lovely, but I choose very carefully. There's a lot of the work I'm offered I don't do. Mm. B, it keeps my brain working, learning. C, it keeps me active. And D, I'm amongst most of my friends, you know. So that's where I work, and I'm 87, and I can't think that myself. No, it's true. My hair has never gone grey, my mother's never did, and my grandmother's never did. I don't know about before then. So the difficulty now is the parts I play, I have to wear a wig to look old enough.
You have to put the grey in.
It's silly, isn't it? It's silly.
That's fabulous.
Yeah.
But you were mentioning about Alan Bennett and this latest Talking Heads. I gather he got you to swear for the first time on the telly.
In this new one? No, it isn't so much swear. Well, yes, one word. But there isn't much I wouldn't do for Alan Bennett because his writing is so brilliant, you know. In the very first line of the play, which I wouldn't dream of telling you, I wouldn't have said that if it had been written by some writers, you know. But he's got such a wonderful idea of life. There's a lot of sadness in this. It's called Waiting for the Telegram. Because unless you are a person old enough to know that in the 1480 war, a telegram came to say if someone had died, been killed. And it was always from the king, as though he had sent it personally. And this is Waiting for a Telegram, but that's all you know. Oh, and by the way, I've been in Last of the Summer Wine 14 years.
14 years?
14 years,
yes. Gosh, we were way out on our number there, weren't we?
But I'm not very much in it. I'm not the important one. The other day, and a lorry pulled up here, and the driver looked out and he said, "Hey, Thora, when are you going to learn to drive?" So what does man?
You were talking about the fact there that you know that you haven't sworn on television. You know, is it a question that you've had such a tight set of morals in your own life that there are things that you just wouldn't have agreed to do on television?
Well, no. I mean, I'm not as good as some people. I have a good religious life. I have a very good arrangement with God. A really good arrangement. As a matter of fact, I had flu last week, and I was wondering whether to let you know last week I couldn't come. And I thought, well, I'll have a bit of a chat with him. And I do. As a matter of fact, you know your floor manager here?
Yes.
Well, I said to God one day, I said, I don't know whether you've got a floor manager or not, But if you have, do you say to him, who is it? And he says, it's Thor again. And do they say, oh, tell her I'm out? Because I ask him that many things. And I said this morning, as soon as I got out the bath, I said, please, God, keep me well enough today. Because I really have... I didn't know whether I'd have to tell you. Yesterday, I couldn't come.
So you talk to him on a daily basis, then?
Oh, I talk to him many times. And then I apologise for pestering him.
Oh, dear. Yeah. I just thought you were talking there about morals. I was sort of making the point that in life you do have a good, strict sense of morals. And you, in passing, mentioned Pete. You know, the chap here was talking about having made love to 400 or 500...
I didn't get the first bit, but I got another programme this morning on television. Same subject.
Yeah. So what do you think of what some would regard as very loose morals?
Well, you might know daily I'm asked either on a phone call or something. And I can never give advice to anybody. I'm so busy giving it to myself. And, of course, at my age, not even your age, because you're not near my age, but it was a different life, added to which it was in the north. Now, I don't mean that we're better living in the north than anywhere else, but it was a very strict life. I mean, I have used it now in two or three comedies, and I shouldn't. They were always very careful when people were ill. I can remember this so well. I have to look at the audience to tell them this. There was someone near us. They said, she's gone in hospital again, hasn't she? I said, yes. What was it this time? And she said... And they never said it was down here or what it was. And so it couldn't be spoken in public, you see, and said, what was it this time? Don't let anybody say I've done it. It's lovely. And I can remember very well, really very well, that we had one prostitute in Morecambe that was known. I mean, there may have been others. People live their life as they want to. And... she had this fox fur on and used to wait outside the gasworks on a Friday night when the only man who had done her really wrong by them producing a child was waiting, and he used to give her this 10-bob note. Remember, anybody old enough here to remember the 10-shilling note that were red? And he used to give her this out of his wage packet. And poor soul, they said in the end, you know, it was for a bottle of Guinness she was doing. It's terrible, isn't it? However, I was never on the beauty style that men walked past me and said, but we all had our boyfriends.
Absolutely.
You know?
Now, listen, I can't let you away from the house without talking about these two books, in fact, that you brought out all at the same time. One is about bygones and the other is Home Truths. But it's all in and around language, isn't it, basically?
Well, yes, I can tell you quickly how the bygones came to mm-hmm. I was speaking after a luncheon at the Grosvenor House. And after dinner, a very nice, smart young fellow, about 24, 25, came up to me. And rather embarrassed, he said, excuse me, Dame Thora, he said, what does courting mean? And I thought he was having me on for a minute, you know, and I said, is this your young lady? And he said, yes, and we're getting married next year. I said, there you are, you're courting. And he said to the girl, there you are. He said, she didn't know either. And on my way home, it was a very little journey to Lancaster Gate from Park Lane, and I thought, what a shame, some words are dying. And it got me thinking, what would a child of 10 say if you said, go and get me a fourpenny gas mantle? They'd say, what? Where I was sent every other day because somebody put a taper through them. Can anybody here remember how fragile they were? And you pulled the thing on and the taper went through and your mother said, look what you've done again. You brought a fourpenny mantle. And so then I started thinking of words that had died. Mm. And the book is about things and words that are no longer. Even up to that, what your mother did on a Monday at the washing day with a posser, with the dolly tub, with the, all these things, are all in a washing machine that you buy now that does it when you press a button.
It's like one of our boys around here didn't know what a mangle was.
No, well, that's it, you see. We had a wooden mangle outside. No, there's so many things.
Well, it's good, Thora, to get them all undercover, and I'm so pleased you came to see us at the house today. It really is, as always, a delight to see you. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.